our culture is in contrast to the message of that video, the Me Church. I hope you have your Bibles open to Mark chapter 8. Hang on. Mark chapter 8. I know I've done all the Bible. Jesus said in verse 34, "Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a Protestant theologian living in Nazi Germany. He was an outspoken critic of the policies of Adolf Hitler, and he was eventually arrested. Just hours before the Allies were to come to the very prison camp where he was held, Hitler had Bonhoeffer executed. He is best known for his book, The Cost of Discipleship, in which he wrote, he penned these words, "Salvation is free, but discipleship will cost you your life." So as we look at Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 38, we're going to look at the call that Jesus gives to every one of us. We're going to look at the conditions of the criteria for discipleship. And then three cautions that Jesus leaves us with. So it says in verse 34, "In calling the crowds to him with his disciples." Jesus had been intently training the disciples. In fact, if you look at verses 27 through 33, Jesus began asking the disciples, who do people say that I am? And then he asked, whom do you say that I am? And that's where Peter is known for his famous statement, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God." He did really good. He got an A plus before he got his F. And then Jesus said, "I need to tell you who I am." In verse 31, he said, that he would suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, be killed, and 3 days be resurrected. Now the disciples heard being criticized by the priests and being killed, and didn't hear about the resurrection. And Peter rebuked Jesus and said, "This will not happen." And that's what Jesus had to say to Peter, "Keep behind me, Satan." Because Jesus knew that he was on the road to the cross. And he could not allow his love for his disciples to hold him back from saving humanity. And so he calls both his disciples and the crowd. Now the crowd, they're the people there looking for food, miracles to take place. And Jesus calls them together. Because see, if I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ, that means that I am his follower, that I'm learning from him, and that I'm desiring to be like him. And so Jesus starts off with the word "if." He says, "If anyone would come after me." And so there are four criteria of discipleship. The first is desire. If anyone would come after me, if anyone would desire to follow me. Now, we cannot create within our minds and our heart the desire to follow Jesus. It is humanly impossible. In Acts the Apostles, page 52, says the Holy Spirit has many roles. But one of them is to come alongside us as disciples of Jesus and to empower us to live differently. Isn't that encouraging? That the Holy Spirit empowers us. It's not our, as John Mayer would say, pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps. It is our being empowered by the Spirit of God to live differently. And in Acts 1:8, when Jesus reminded the apostles, "You will receive power from the Holy Spirit, and you will be my witnesses." In other words, we are able to witness about Jesus, not because we're smart or intelligent or gifted, but because we have power from the Holy Spirit. In verse 34 it says, whoever will come after me. That means that we are intentionally following Jesus Christ. Now there are three groups of people that Jesus is talking to. There are those who are curious in the crowd, who are already committed to Jesus, but they'd like to know a little more about him. Then there's that committed core, specifically the disciples. And then there's the counterfeit, people like Judas. And in, even though it was 2,000 years ago, today we still have those three groups. There are some of us that are curious about Christ. There are others of us that are committed to Christ, and there are some of us who are counterfeits. And what is encouraging is, even though Jesus knew those three groups were there, he was calling every one of them and saying, if you desire, follow me. Now, the good news as disciples, we're all on the same playing field. Romans 3:23, we have all sinned. In Acts 10:34, everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of his sins. So he says in verse 34, come after me. So I leave you with a question this morning. Do you have a desire to follow Jesus? Do you have a desire to be a disciple? Not a desire that you create, because there are a lot of people who desire it. A desire to give up chocolate, a desire to give up snack foods or junk food. But it is desire to surrender completely to Jesus. And that comes to us from the Holy Spirit. That desire Jesus is talking about is described in Psalm 73, verse 25. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. When you think about all the things of this earth that we can accumulate, there's nothing as amazing as the time we have with Jesus. Like Bonhoeffer said, salvation is free, but discipleship will cost you your life. Our Western culture highly values comfort and ease. But God is not concerned about making us comfortable or at ease. He is only interested in making us holy. Every Christian is called to a clear and dedicated life as a disciple, whatever the cost may be. Now the first quality is desire, the second quality is denial. Let him deny himself, Jesus said. Now, everything in our culture screams out and says no to that. Because to deny means to refuse. One commentary puts it this way, to disown and renounce self, to subjugate all works, interests, and enjoyments. Luke 14:33 says, so therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be a disciple. Now, denial is not the same as self-denial. Denial is not saying no to chocolate. The last time I told you that, collaboratively, Americans eat 100 pounds of chocolate every second. Self-denial is saying no to chocolate, but that's not the kind of denial Jesus is talking about. Self-denial is saying, I won't look at Facebook for a week, or cheer for the Dolphins. Well, that may be a good thing to do. But denying self means no longer saying that I'm in charge, but allowing God to be in charge of my life. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6:19 through 20, well, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you are bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. In short, I must give up the right to run my life, because it's no longer mine to run. Let me illustrate it with the Apostle Peter. Peter was condemned to die on the cross. It was the first time that both he and Paul were in the same city at the same time, both in prison, both about to die. Peter, because he was not a Roman citizen, would die by crucifixion. Paul, because he was a Roman citizen, would die by beheading. But the prospect of this fearful, violent death to Peter was an honor. Acts of Apostles, we got Acts of Apostles 5:38. He counted it a joy to yield up his life for the gospel, feeling only that for him who had denied his Lord to die in the same manner as his master died was too great an honor. Peter had denied his Lord at the time when he needed him most. He repented of that, and he knew he had been forgiven for that. And Peter had faithfully served his Lord as an ambassador for Christ. But he just didn't feel that he had the honor to die like Jesus died, so he requested that he be crucified upside down. And this man died the great Apostle Peter. I came across a New Year's resolution. What is worthy for our attention is that there is one resolution we should all make, that we will not begin a single day in the new year without giving thanks to God, meditating on one chapter of God's Word, praying, glorifying God yourself in your life today at my expense. Most of us are good at glorifying God. We're not quite as good as sacrificing. There's a group, a singing group called Mercy Me, and they have a song called So Long Self. And the words describe a man breaking up with himself. And the phrase is repeated several times, So Long Self. Have you broken up with yourself? Because there's really no room for both of us on the throne of our hearts. Either self is on the throne, or the Savior is on the throne of our lives. Salvation is free, but discipleship could cost you your life. The third quality is death. You know, Paul talks in Romans 7 about a woman who was married to a man who was very demanding, and nothing she could do would please him. She tried everything, the way she cooked, the way she cleaned house, the way she dressed. Nothing satisfied him. She could never measure up to his expectations. Then she met another man who loved her, cared for her. And she said to the second man, "We need to kill the first man, my first husband, so I can marry you." And he said, "No." He said, "You must die." See, we can't earn salvation. And the only way to be a disciple for Christ is to die to self. And to let God live in our lives and to be empowered by his Holy Spirit. So when Jesus said, "Take up the cross," that was strong language for his day, because during his lifetime there had been over 30,000 crucifixions. Every person who was a believer who heard these words, "Take up your cross," they realized it was an act of shame, of suffering, of torture, and of cruel death. When a person took up his cross, he was beginning a death march. But we have Romanized. It's close. We've made the cross nice, gentle. We put it in our churches. People even wear them around their crosses, the crosses around their necks. Sometimes we say, "Well, that's just the cross I must bear." Maybe it's a belligerent relative, or maybe it's a health issue. maybe it's a problem with a boss or a job issue or family issue. So that's just a cross I have to bear. But that's not what Jesus is talking about. The cross was carried by condemned criminals, and ended with a humiliating, excruciating execution. Everybody knew that when they bore their cross, they were saying goodbye to everything, and there was no turning back. We are called to crucify the cult of self, the cult of self-fulfillment, the cult of self-promotion, and the cult of self-centeredness. We are to die to our rights, the right to be right, the right to take revenge, the right to fight. A religion which costs nothing is worth how much? Nothing. 11 of the disciples would die as martyrs for Jesus Christ. Only John did not. Of course, Judas took his own life. Came across this quote: "The cross is relentless in my life. It pursues and crucifies my claims on self-rule and self-glory." Christ lays hold of our ambitions, our money, our mind, our work, and our children. We can no longer own everything. We can no longer own anything. But we must submit ourselves to Jesus. Bonhoeffer also wrote, "In a time of cheap grace and easy believism, where Christianity is more identified with health and wealth than surrender, sacrifice, and service." He also wrote, "When Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and to die." Paul said in Galatians 2, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And this life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." Are you willing to die yourself? Are you willing to die to Christ that he might live within you? Are you willing to accept that salvation is free and the discipleship it costs to your life? The fourth characteristic is devotion. After surrendering your desire, denying self, and dying to sin, Jesus says in verse 34, "Follow me." Follow me is where to go along with him. That Jesus goes before us and we're behind him, following him wherever he leads us. Remember that poem about the footprints? And the man asked, "Lord, there were two sets of prints. When I was in my worst issues of life, there were only one set of footprints. Where were you?" And the poem, Jesus responds, "I was carrying you." Follow me, Jesus says. It is the code word, or the core word of discipleship. It means to be a learner and a follower of Jesus Christ. Think of the rich young ruler in Mark 10. He said, "What must I do to be saved?" Well, his first premise of his question was wrong, because there's nothing we can do to save ourselves. And Jesus said, "Give away all your wealth. Surrender your idolatry to materialism." In verse 22, he says, "Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions." Jesus did not run after this man. As much as he loved him, as much as he would long for him to be one of his disciples, he did not run after him, and he did not water down the demands of discipleship. Jesus doesn't lower the fact that it is costly to follow him. The man was sad because he had great possessions. In Matthew 10:38, Jesus said, "And whoever does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me." Cross bearers are called to follow the crucified. Discipleship is demanding because it is, we are to die to our desires. In Luke 9:23, it says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. See, it's easy to add Jesus to Facebook as a friend. It's more difficult to follow Jesus. Jesus is not an app that we add to our life, because he wants to be the Lord of our entire life. Are you prepared to denounce all your possessions and follow Jesus Christ? Will you put your faith over your family and over everything else that's been first in your life? Luke 14:33, so therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Yes, salvation is free, but discipleship costs your life. So after Jesus outlines these four qualities, then he gives some cautions. He says, if you focus only on your life, you'll lose it. In verse 35, it says, for whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. If you try to hold on to what you have, you'll miss all that Jesus wants to give you. When you settle the surrender issue and commit to following Christ at any cost, you end up saving your life. The Apostle Paul said in Acts 20:24, but I do not count my life of any value, nor is it precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I have received from the Lord Jesus Christ to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And don't miss what Mark puts in when Mark says, whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. We may lose our lives in service to the Lord, but he promises us that our lives will be saved. And speaking of commitment, Revelation 12:11 says, for they love not their lives even to death. That reminds me of the words of Jim Elliot, a missionary to Ecuador, who was killed by the Ecuador Indians. He said, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. If you focus only on your own success, you'll lose your life. You'll lose your walk with the Lord. Jesus asked two probing questions. Verse 36, for what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? Well, Jesus is using economic terms like profit and forfeit. You can gain everything, he said, and you can lose your soul. Will you spend your life for the Savior, or will you waste your life for the world? In verse 38, Jesus said, for whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Yes, there is a cost to discipleship, but there is an even greater cost to not being a disciple of Jesus Christ. We are called to confess Christ. We are called not to be ashamed of Christ. Even though our culture disagrees with us. Paul wrote in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, Jew first, and also to the Greek. So who's on the throne of your heart? Self or Jesus? That must be my morning. Is the New Smyrna Beach Church a me church or a disciple church? The choice is really up to you. putting Christ first or our culture first. Let's pray. Father in heaven,
the devil
is constantly assailing us, constantly reminding us the cost of discipleship. Lord, help us not to be deceived by Satan. Help us to surrender ourselves, our desires, to be willing to die because we've been empowered by your Spirit. Help us, Lord, realize how helpless we are without your Spirit. And help us, Lord, no matter what trial comes our way, no matter what arrows or darts that the devil throws at us, that we serve a powerful God. We pray in Jesus' name.